morning I have just a couple of thoughts I would like to share with you based on the 28th chapter of the Gospel of Matthew that we read at the opening this morning. And since we don't have bulletins, I will tell you that I have entitled this brief message, Two Views of the Empty Tomb. First, I'd like to specifically look at verse 8 that reads, "So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples." Look at how the women reacted at the news of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They were afraid, yet filled with joy. And I think we can give them a pass on being afraid because there was so much that they couldn't understand at this time. Now, I'm not going to stand here and tell you that if I were in their position, I wouldn't be afraid either. Sure, I would. You see, there is a bad kind of fear. That is the kind of fear that Jesus warned us about when he said, "Fear not." And that's a fear that's born of a sense of doubt who God is. But the women showed a different kind of fear, which is more or less a fear of the unknown. You see, the news of the resurrection of Jesus filled them with joy. And you know, some things never change, as they say, as the news should fill us with joy on this very day. There's an important distinction that we teach our children, the difference between Christmas Day and Easter Day. Such a production seems to be made on a Christmas Day that children and even many adults end up thinking that Christmas Day is the most important day of the year. And sure, Christmas Day is very important because it does signify the birth of Jesus Christ, and Jesus certainly had to be born in the first place for everything else to take place after that. Then he had to live the perfect life, he had to be betrayed, he had to suffer on the cross, and all those other things. But even so, it was simply not enough for Jesus to be born. Now just imagine that Friday evening of that week so long ago, Jesus was dead. He was in the tomb. Imagine the disciples. I'm sure that they couldn't believe that their friend and teacher had just died that very day. And just think, they wake up Saturday morning and Jesus is still dead. There's no sign of him. They're trying to still make sense of the events of the previous day in their minds. And imagine the despair that the disciples must have felt going to bed Saturday night. You know, what are they going to do tomorrow? You know, Jesus is gone now. They've spent 3 years of their lives walking and learning from this man. Well, they might even wonder if those 3 years are down the drain just like that. Again, Saturday night, no sign of Jesus. He's dead and lying in a tomb. The night gets darker. Their despair grows. But you know what? We know that the night sky is the darkest just before the sun comes up in the morning. Part of that is because the moon is heading towards the west now and the moon is setting, and what little light that provides at night is diminishing as well. And we don't have that direct full moon light overhead. So the darkness of the night represents the despair that the whole world experienced during those 3 days. It's a very dark despair. And you might say that it would take an act of God to brighten the world after that experience. And an act of God really does occur every single morning whenever the sun rises in the east. On that special Sunday morning, the sun did come up like it did every day before and every day since. But the good news is it wasn't the only sun to come up, was it? The Son of God also got up too. It was the most significant event in the history of mankind. And that was when Jesus Christ resurrected from the grave. That morning, the most important sun rose. That's the S-O-N, sun. Giving joy to the women who went to the tomb on that wonderful morning, and it still gives joy to everyone who believes in him on this very special day. I'd like to move on now to the opposite aspect from the women that we see in the same chapter. And we read in Matthew 28 how the women were overjoyed. But what about the chief priests and the guards of the tomb? Do you think they were overjoyed whenever Jesus' body was gone from the tomb? Not quite. In verse 12 through 15, it says, when the chief priests had met with the elders and devised a plan, they gave the soldiers a large sum of money, telling them, you are to say, his disciples came during the night and stole him away while we were asleep. This report gets to the governor, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble. So the soldiers took the money and did as they were instructed. Those who were pure in heart that morning were overjoyed, and they, of course, ran to tell others of the news too. But on the other hand, those who were not pure of heart, they responded to the resurrection with lies and deception. And it's a common reaction of a person who rejects God, lies and deception. Because if a person will admit the truth that Jesus Christ is alive, then that person also has to admit that the reason that they don't follow God, if they don't do his will, is not because they don't believe in God. They know the truth that Jesus Christ is alive. The truth is that they don't follow God because they hate God. That is the truth. Romans 1:20 tells us that everyone knows God exists. I'll just summarize the words of Paul when he writes, God's eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse. This isn't anything that we haven't seen before either. The Old Testament speaks of that same concept in Psalm 19, verse 1. That says, the heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. To doubt the obvious fact that God exists is to engage in the same kinds of lies and deception that the chief priests and the guards engaged in when they realized that the tomb was empty. And the tomb is still empty today, isn't it? And it gives us a sense of joy. It's a sense of joy that we can never experience from anything else in this world. All who believe in that empty tomb will feel more joy in their hearts on this day than any other day of the year. Today we remember the greatest miracle that God ever performed, the raising of his son, Jesus Christ, from the dead. And it's not just bringing a man back to life either. This is the miracle of salvation that was finally made available to all mankind. It was a miracle not only because God overcame the forces of nature, but it's also a miracle because God chose to exercise his infinite grace when he didn't have to. God never had to send Jesus Christ to earth in the first place, but he did so simply because he is a loving God. It's because he loves you and he loves me. And the Bible tells us God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but would have everlasting life. So at this time, I would like to take a few minutes just in quiet prayer wherever you're sitting. This is an opportunity to pray to God about whatever's on your heart. It's your time to spend with God for the next few minutes. Now that the sun is up, I know it's a little cloudy, but we can tell through the stained glass that the sun is up. Let God's light of goodness shine into our hearts and fill our souls on this day and guide our prayers to him. After a couple of minutes, then I will lead us to prayer. Then we will close out our sunrise service with the hymn, Near the Cross. I believe that's number 407 in your hymnal. Before departing for breakfast, We'll now take just a few minutes of quiet prayer.